Before I get started with the formal stuff, and I don't want to make this too PowerPoint intensive, I don't have a huge number of slides because death by PowerPoint doesn't help anyone really. And you don't need me talking at you. In fact, you possess so much knowledge already. Some of you have published, others of you will be nearly ready to publish, and all of you, I would suggest, will have to publish at some point out of your PhD. That is the standard model these days for a certainly science PhD at this university is to publish lots of papers. So I wouldn't mind just getting a bit of an idea of who we've got in the room, just 30 seconds each of where you're up to in your PhD, whether you've published, you know, just generally who you are and what the hell you're doing here. Okay, well, let's make a start. Now, we'll skip through some of this sort of introductory stuff, but it's very important to know your target journal and to know why it's your target journal, because sometimes it's kind of a scattergun approach that people adopt, or they don't really know their journal very well. So I do suggest that you do your research on the journals and have a publication plan. For confirmation, anyway, you'll be facing that fairly soon. You have to have thought this through because that's examined at confirmation, that you thought about where you're going to target your publication. No one holds you to it, but what they want to see, the whole point of that is that they want to see if you've started the process of thinking about it. And thinking about, you know, obviously impact factors and things like that are important, but also more importantly, the group of people you definitely want to know about your research. So put some time and effort. Time spent on that is actually time well spent, making sure that you're getting the right place to put your material. And of course, the style guide. And they should not have to jog your memory about this. This is where you have to be quite proactive. And style guides are so different between journals. And they're very, very pedantic. And you know, they will care about where you place that little full stop. You know, so you do have to familiarise yourself. Sometimes they designate the length of a dash. So is it an N dash or an M dash? That kind of thing. So make sure you understand it and be willing to be very flexible, because when you move between journals, then you have to change your style completely quite often. Style is a whole other subject. We'd spend a day on that. We won't. But it's something you have to learn early in your careers to be quite, as our Prime Minister would put it, agile. When it comes to fixing, you know, getting a style in place that is able to adapt to a number of different circumstances. You should also get into the habit of outlining each paper that you do, and perhaps even having a template. Obviously, you have to, once again, be adaptable, but getting into the habit of not just sitting down to write a paper, but actually setting it out. And I like to use a table. Other people do it differently. You might have a mud map or, you know, whatever. But it's a very good idea to have a structure in mind, and not just the big macro structure, but a deeper structure into subsections as well. So we'll look at that just briefly when we look at the Nature publication. You must form a journal club if you haven't already. Is anyone here in a journal club? Oh, no. Journal clubs are really, really helpful because they develop your critical reading skills, which inevitably lead to critical writing. So what you want to do is get a small group, probably six or seven within the centre, people who've got some synergies in what they're doing, and designate, you know, each time you meet, and it could be once every 2 weeks or once a month, someone selects an article, and of course you all read it, and then you form a group, have a cup of coffee or lunch, and you talk about what's in it. And I suggest, because I'm a writer, so I would say this, that you're not just looking at the scientific content, although of course that's what we are looking at, but you're also examining it for other things as well, for clarity, for style, for ease of expression, you know, the things that are to do with scientific communication as well, not just the raw scientific information in the article. So it's actually very helpful if you can start developing a habit of looking critically at other people's writing, because it's amazing what a difference that makes to your own writing. Sometimes the examples are negative examples of what not to do, but other times you'll see a really good writer and you just shamelessly steal their style, you know, not their words, but But I know when I was a young journalist, when I first started out, I had a few writing heroes who I shamelessly stole the style of George Orwell, for example, and Clive James. You know, these are people who have gone on influencing me right through my career. So, you just start to observe deeply what other people are doing, and then it can make a big difference. Becoming a journal reviewer as well is a really, good way to get good at this as well. Is anyone reviewing at the moment? It's just a bit like teaching, when you start reviewing, you start to see the nuts and bolts of journal articles, and it can really help you to understand the process. So if you have that opportunity, and some of you are very early on and it's not the right time, but maybe towards the end, it's a good idea to pick up on any opportunities like that. There are so many journals now, they sometimes struggle to get good, well-qualified reviewers, so those opportunities tend to be there. It's hard work, and it's thankless work in some ways, but it's very rewarding in the sense that your own writing is going to improve, so give it some thought. Write early and write often. Those of you who are just within your first few weeks, you should be writing now. I know that sounds mad because you don't have any results yet, but there are many things you can be writing, including literature, obviously, literature review, proposal information. I suggest a whole range of other things that might shock you a bit, such as the thesis abstract. You can start writing that pretty early on, maybe after you've done your literature review. There's plenty of writing you need to be doing because it's like any muscle. You have to keep exercising it to get any good at it. What I don't like to see, and I've seen it often enough, is people who have had a ball doing data gathering. They've been out on the Great Barrier Reef, diving, having a great time, lots and lots of data sets, all really good stuff, but they haven't done any writing at all until, on their little Gantt chart, they've put writing 4 weeks at the end of their 3.5 years, and people can't do it. It's a book that you're writing. A book takes a while. I've got a book coming out shortly, and I know how long that took to write. That's a research book. And so you have to treat your thesis like a book, and so you have to be writing all the way through. So write early, write often. Do it while you're out in the field or doing lab work. Even a little bit each day is going to help, and you'll be very glad of it when you've got some raw material to be drawing upon when you sit down to write, because it's horrible when you've got a blank computer screen. It's really frightening when you don't have anything. So at least you'll have something. You may have to alter it quite a bit. You may have to do a lot of massaging. That's fine. That's part of the process. And in that process, you're actually learning what you've got anyway. So this is a research skill just as much as data gathering.
Well, so I did do that quite a bit during the first couple of years of my PhD. And actually, when I cut and paste everything from all my different drafts into one document, it actually equaled 34 pages. And so it's one of those things where, you start off with an idea and you write with that, and it's almost, you sort of rein that in as you're, in the data collection, and then you read an inspiring article or you collect more data and it looks like the story is going another way, and so you start reading and compiling it into another document. So write early and often, I would say do it, but make sure that you, one, know where all your drafts are located, because that can take quite a bit of time to look at it.
Yes.
And also, you have to really look at a critical eye when you're revisiting the stuff that you wrote early.
Because
your ideas have evolved and sometimes completely changed.
It's amazing how much it evolves. Your understanding changes completely. So yes, you always have to bring it recognition to using material you've written before. But you can generally refine it and bring it back into line with what you're thinking now. And also, it just gives you the idea, it trains you to be writing right from the beginning. And I think it's so important. There have been too many cases where people just fall over at the end because it's not just they haven't got words on the page, they don't know how to approach the writing task because they haven't done it. So that's part of it. But yes, that's a very good insight. So thanks for that. And you could potentially use some of the exercise we're doing today as a focus, because sometimes people get overwhelmed and are not quite sure where to start. So some of the things we're doing today will give a starting point. You don't have to start at the first sentence of the introduction, and some people don't even like to write the introduction until they've written many other parts of the paper. That's very much a personal choice, and I don't dictate how people, the order in which people do it, but quite often people like to start with the results and sort of spread out from there, and that's perfectly fine too. But the exercises today will just direct your attention to parts of the paper that are worthwhile working on, even from today. You know, you can use this as a starting point for a really brilliant paper. I'd like to see the papers that come out of this, actually. Send them to me. I'd love to see them. So plan what you're going to say and develop a clear professional style. This is a professional task. It's a generic skill that is expected. It's kind of taken as read by the time you graduate. But of course, we see a vast disparity in people's abilities in this field by the time they get to the end of their PhD. I'd like to think the centre takes this very seriously, and so they would expect that all of you will have a very good professional style by the time you get to the end. Don't distract the reader. Now, this will be the journal editor and the peer reviewers, of course. Write technically correct and clear prose, please. This is a baseline. So the peer reviewers engage with your ideas, not your writing errors. What you don't want to get is a great big barrage of complaints about grammar and usage and punctuation coming back at you, because that means, that would say to me that they've been just thinking about the surface qualities of the writing rather than engaging with the ideas. I'm not going to embarrass anyone by asking what sort of writing feedback you've had from peer reviewers, but I know that it can be quite confronting to get a negative peer review come back. And so what you want to do is try and avoid that ever happening. And here's just a little thing about the five stages of peer review. There's denial to begin with. Reviewer 3 says, I do not find the version of the manuscript acceptable. Then anger, with a bit of swearing in there about reviewer 3. We all hate reviewer 3. Then bargaining. So then you start to think how you might be able to, you know, negotiate around points reviewer 3 has made. Depression, because you think, no, that's not going to work. And this paper is never going to get published. And then acceptance. We are pleased to inform you that your paper is being accepted. One time, one of my books, this is going back a few years ago, and it was a team of authors, went out to peer review to 3 peer reviewers. It went through, it was with Oxford, and went through a huge peer review process. And 2 of the peer reviews were absolutely fantastic, really glowing and wonderful. Reviewer 3, though, he hated, I know it's a he, I don't know who it was, but the publishers gave it away by saying he, but he hated the book in every particular. He absolutely hated it, and he went through and his comments were deeply personal. Like, this person, the person who wrote this chapter is an idiot, that sort of level of peer review. And it was very disconcerting, apart from anything else. I mean, apart from hurt feelings and everything, but it was pretty disconcerting because this was a major book for this publisher. And so we had a phone book up. And the publisher, fortunately, was pretty sensible and wasn't rattled by it. But after the initial shock of seeing that review, then I went and read it again a few days later, and I thought, well, maybe there is a kernel of truth in some of this really terrible personal attack. And so I could see that there were some things, because it was a very detailed, it was a long review, and there were some things that were actually quite useful to know. And so as a result, we all went back and made some changes. We decided to ignore others, and we, as a result, I think ended up with a better book. And it ended up, a few months later, winning a publishing award. So, in fact, we could probably thank Reviewer 3 in some ways for making it better. So sometimes it hurts, but it's a good idea to try and be as constructive as possible, even when you hate Reviewer 3. Okay, so clarity is the word that I insist upon, and this is the word that has to be the guiding focus for whatever you do. Clarity is an iron rule, I think, in scientific or research communication of various kinds. And it's actually quite a high standard, because what you think is clear to you, because you're deeply embedded in your project, may not be clear to another person. That's why journal club and writing circles are good, because then you can test it with your peers. So, but we do need to adopt clarity as a principle. You've got to have some technical understanding of English to do this well. You don't have to be a grammarian or a big pedant like me, but you do have to know enough to be able to recognise subject, verb, object, sentence structure, for example, or be able to recognise prepositions and the correct use of prepositions, the correct use and inflection of verbs, you know, changing the form of the verb depending on the purpose. So some of that is kind of in there as what you need to do, which is why I'll supply some basic grammatical information which you might like to make available. Because it's important you get some of these things right. And peer reviewers tend to be, well, a lot, not all of them, but some of them tend to be quite pedantic. So you don't want to distract them with anything that's technically incorrect. So we want clear, grammatical, well-punctuated sentences because they transmit ideas without confusion, and that's what we're looking for. Strong writing and editing skills. So take an interest in writing and editing through journal club or in other ways. Write other types of things as well. You know, write on the conversation website, for example. Quite often there are really interesting articles in your field and you can contribute to the conversation by adding something at the bottom of the article. Just practice writing really clearly and see what comes back because people will pick you up if you've made a mistake. So that's the kind of thing where people can develop their writing skills. You have to be clear what you want to say. This is a shock, but you do. And the only way you can do this is by writing earlier rather than later, by moving words around on the page, because otherwise it's kind of unformed in your head. You kind of know what you want to say, but until you commit it to the page, then you don't really have it. So moving words around on the page. For instance, thesis abstract, I mentioned that before, as something you could start quite early in the piece. Now, don't just write your thesis abstract after you've been for 6 months and then expect to produce it in toto at the end. It's not going to work. It's actually got to be a dynamic document that moves around as your understanding changes, and you revisit it fairly regularly. I did this with my PhD. My abstract was a totally different animal by the time I got to the end, but it was actually quite good because it was a barometer of my own understanding as I went along. And by the end, it was very focused. So moving words on the page is a powerful way of getting things to come together. Yes?
I also find it really helps if you say it out loud.
Yes,
I struggle with reading something without helping it or making it make sense in your ear as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm a former ABC journalist. I would always read my scripts out loud. You know, it's one thing to see it written, and it looks okay, but only when you read it out loud and you're hearing it.
Like, does that make sense? Or is that the right
thing? And you can pick things up that you just can't see with your eyes.
Yeah.
Ears and eyes, some of you will know about physiology, you know, processing. So, yeah, it's a very good tip, actually, to do that. Don't use cliches. Think about fresh expression. Think about, I'm not talking about getting too creative here, but think about how you want your readers to respond to what you've written, and fresh expression, instead of just falling back into this impacted, facilitated, think about, you know, more vivid language use within, you know, limits, of course, but readers do respond to it. And some of the very best papers are written by people who have that slight willingness to go into fresh areas of expression. And I always quote, and some of you will have heard me say this, the Nobel laureate Wiley-Blackburn, Australian scientist, a biochemist. Her writing is so clear and so beautiful, and it's very, you know, she's writing for her peers, it's very scientific, but there's a freshness to it and a willingness to try different formulations instead of just falling back onto what everyone else does. You want to stand out. Center of excellence, you want to be as excellent as you can be. So think about fresh expression and not just falling into the same patterns as everyone else. Okay, you don't just do research, you have to write research as well. And it's important that you understand this, that it's equally important. It's not off to the side, but it's equally important to data gathering and all the other things that you're doing. So this is the only way, this is your interface with the rest of your discipline. In most cases, unless you're presenting at a conference, which also involves thinking about language. So you've got to really take it on board as a serious thing. If you understand the primacy of good language use, then you're part of the way down the track. It really does help. Not everything, and I'll come to that in a moment, but it's not everything. Please value the sentence. The sentence is a miracle of human communication. It's amazing. We just take it for granted, but we're the only creatures that we know of that actually formulate sentences or have abstract, complex languages like this. And unfortunately, we too often torture and abuse our sentences. And I'm not just saying that off the top of my head. I see it every day in the material that people send to me. And quite often people go, yeah, sentences, whatever. Of course we know that sentence is important. And then I get material from them where they've got 130-word sentences all the way through. You know, and you just go, maybe it does need to be stated, even if it sounds obvious, that you have to think about your sentence structure, you have to think about what the sentence is for, each sentence transmitting an idea, sometimes joining concepts together using sentence structure devices such as conjunctions and other formulations. But you have to value it. And if you take care of your sentences, then quite often the rest of the document comes together better. We also have to think about paragraph structure, and we have to think about section structure and all of those things, and an overarching sort of idea as well. But the sentence is a good focal point and something you really need to think about. Correctly structured, that deploy keywords. Each sentence will have keywords. These are the words of substance in the sentence. They tend to be the subject, which is a noun, perhaps a noun phrase, the verb, and then the object, which is a noun or a noun phrase as well. There are lots and lots of other kinds of words. There are articles, there are prepositions, there are conjunctions, there are participles, there are lots of different things. But you have to be able to identify your keywords and make them inhabit those positions, grammatical positions. So we'll think a little bit about that in a moment. Start your theme sentences, that's the first sentence of each paragraph, with keywords. So if it's fish, or a particular species of fish, try and get that near the start rather than a pronoun or some other word that's less important to the meaning of the sentence. It makes, on a subconscious level, the reader takes it in better when they can see at the start of the sentence what the sentence is about. So don't have strings of dead words. It is thought that because of B. Doesn't work, particularly at the beginning of paragraphs. Keep your subject and verb close together as well, and we'll look at this. Some people like to put the subject here, then have lots of adjunct information between them. We have the verb, you know, down here somewhere, and they can lose their connection. That's a fundamental grammatical connection, subject and verb, so try not to interfere with it. And limit the number of words per sentence. I'm going to give you some rules about this as we go along. Now, when I say rules, obviously no one's going to fine you if you disobey, but just from your own sort of discipline point of view, in terms of your writing discipline, if you can stick to the word limits that I'm going to suggest a bit later, then that makes a huge difference to your professional writing ability and to your readability. And readability is what it comes down to, actually. You have to draw people in. They want to read it. There's an interesting idea. They get carried along because the keyword's in the right position, they've got a reason to keep going, they can see the meaning, they don't have to reread. Another rule you should know about is the one read rule, where your target audience, whoever that happens to be, should be able to read it just once and understand it immediately. You shouldn't force them to reread things. The more you do that, the more they'll hate it. So one read rule, keep that in mind. It's a very powerful thing. And that's why you do need to have a writing circle so you can test that, because you can't always see it yourself. Okay, I've just got a few sentence writing tips which I hope will help you. These are a little bit random because there are many, many ways to structure sentences. But these are just based on things that I've observed in academic writing, some of the things that could be done better. The number of times people just chuck the preposition with for any particular reason. You know, they're so vague, and I think this is the problem, that if you're not very precise with your language use, you tend to reach for the vague expressions, such as the word with, and the whole range of verbs that I mentioned before. So we end up with something like this. With recent surveys, it has been shown that pollution has increased. is a poor formulation. Start with keywords. Recent surveys have shown an increase in pollution. It is a far better way. Now, you can see that this is not grammatically incorrect, but it's not the best way to express something. So think about how you're going to deploy it. This is also a bit shorter, and concision is a good thing. You don't want people to be bogged down in too many words when you can actually get it said more efficiently with fewer words. And using with as a conjunction, so temperatures were taken daily with water samples taken every week, is a poor form of expression. Instead, you should have temperatures were taken daily and water samples were taken every week is a better way of putting it. Can I also suggest, I haven't got it here, but a lot of people say on a daily basis, which, you know, that's like wading through treacle. So just use the word daily. If you can use a single word instead of a phrase, then go for that option. You do not have to load your writing up with all these, what I call freeloaders, these words that are not doing anything. Now, I've had an academic say to me recently, but it looks more intellectual if you say on a daily basis. But you'll find that the very best academic writers, and I always look to the Nobel laureates, they know, they have the confidence to know that it's better to be more direct. And so that's what you should aim to do as much as you can. Don't use with when you mean and or because. So with his teeth falling out, he went to the dentist. He's a really bad one. Because his teeth were falling out, he went to the dentist. Establish the relationships more clearly within sentences. Overuse of use or using. Capture of marine housets, which are a hot area of study these days. Capture of marine housets is achieved by using nets and wire hoops. Doesn't really work. Marine housets are caught in wet nets and wire hoops is a better way. We get the marine housets at the start as well. So, or wood and plastic are also used by some experimenters as a means to control excess radiation. It's not ideal. Excess radiation has been contained by wood and plastic is probably a better way. Now, once again, it's an art, not a science. It's a feel thing. You don't necessarily have to do it exactly like this. You can feel your way around this, but just know that this is, you know, nearly twice as long. It's less direct. It places emphases perhaps wrongly. So look at your own work, isolate some sentences that you've written already and see whether you're doing these kinds of things and try to turn it around. See what a difference it makes to readability. So I've just made the point here that the change in grammatical subject here from wooden plastic to excess radiation, that's what I meant by placing emphases. English language is very linear. And if you place things in the position of grammatical subject at the start of the sentence, you're going to emphasise that subtly more than anything that follows. So other languages don't operate like this, and it's really interesting because in the past I've studied ancient Greek and Latin, and they actually do it quite differently. They're not linear, but English certainly is. Oh, definitely avoid too many prepositional phrases. This is a genuine problem. Prepositions, those little words like in, from, for, by, with, they govern what nouns do. So they send your nouns in all different directions. So if you have too many of them in a sentence, it gets awfully confusing, like this. It is a matter of the gravest possible importance to the health of anyone with a history of a problem with disease of the heart that he or she should avoid sort of foods with a high percentage of saturated fats. And all the prepositions are underlined there. Now, that is sending people in all sorts of directions, so you need to simplify that. Anyone with a history of heart disease should avoid saturated fats might be a better way of saying the same thing. And often that's all you need, you know, like... You don't have to overdo the detail quite often. Now, I don't want you to underdo it as well, because your supervisors might ring me up and say, you told them to take all the detail out. No, I'm not saying that. You have to find, it's a feel for concision. That's what you want, to be able to say everything you need to say. Now, just remember, concision is not just brevity. Concision is also completeness. Is saying everything you need to say in the fewest number of words. So it's important that you get that spirit of concision and not just see it as brevity alone, that in fact you have to be complete in the message that you're trying to send. When you start self-editing, though, just be aware that one of the great skills of editing is to be able to cut judiciously. And in fact, I call it the chainsaw massacre, so it's not that judicious. But being able to get the idea that you take your first or early drafts, which are almost inevitably too big, and you get in there and you chop, 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 chop in such a way that you actually bring the meaning out instead of letting it stay buried. So that's part of what you're trying to do. Having a go. Academics love having lots of havings. So 2-minute treatment of flour having an initial moisture content of 20% will give a product having all the desirable properties, etc. You know, this is not good professional writing. This is untrained writing. A trained writer is probably going to write it a bit differently, removing the havings. 2-minute treatment of flour that has an initial moisture content will give a product, etc. So just look for those little things. Sometimes this is completely unconscious. You don't even know you're doing this. But I'm asking you now to start noticing. And noticing not only when you do it, but when other people do it as well. So through journal club or other ways of looking at other people's writing. And start thinking about what is more graceful, what is more eloquent, what is more concise, what is more efficient. These are very important keywords for your writing. I've got my Liz's tips. And I'll just go through these quickly. I've got millions of them, but these are best started. Check the grammar of your sentences. We want subject, verb, object. Subject, what the sentence is about. The verb, so the subject is acting through the verb onto the direct object. That's the basis of all English sentences, except we've got the passive equivalent, which is flipped around. Don't worry. You need to be able to discern that structure. I'm going to send some notes so that you can start to understand this a bit better. But you need to be able to see that structure and see how those elements are working together. And if necessary, restructure so that you achieve complete grammatical correctness. Now, the biggest problem that people have is the mismatch between the subject and the verb. And that's because they've loaded up the information between the subject and the verb and they've forgotten that the subject is singular and they put a plural verb down here or vice versa. That is a major technical problem. It will be noticed by people who understand this stuff. So you want to make sure that you've got that technical correctness. Count the number of words. I mentioned this is my little rule. Do not exceed 25 words for a theme sentence. That's the first sentence of the paragraph. And the other sentences may range from 5 to 50 words with either extreme rare. 5-word sentences are really nice little signposts sometimes. You can not do it too often because it starts to look like play school, but a 5-word sentence every so often just to perhaps shift the focus onto a new thing, provide a link. 5-word sentence is a nice thing to do. 50 words is a very long sentence. You would only do this occasionally and generally if you have a list that you have to include in a sentence. In most scientific disciplines, you're not allowed to use dot points. You have to write it into a sentence. So I have seen massive long lists. Just so you know, readers hate long sentences that contain lists. So if you have one that goes over 50 words, think about how you can regroup the information slightly differently so you can separate it. Have a look at the clauses in the sentence too. These are simple sentences that are joined together to make a complex or compound sentence. I've seen some sentences that run to, 10 clauses. This is ridiculous. You know, the reader cannot possibly follow all the way through because clauses are joined together in sentences for a reason. You're trying to establish a relationship between the elements that are contained within each clause. If you've got 10, then people lose sight of the relationships you're trying to form here. So keep it to about 3 or 4 as a maximum. And also make sure you can recognise what a clause is. Generally, just knowing a word limit is going to help you with this anyway, because you can't get 10 clauses generally into a 50-word sentence, so it's going to naturally improve once you start imposing word limits.
Can you give us an example of a sentence with clauses?
I might even have one. I'm not sure if I put it in. I do sometimes show a multi-clause sentence. What it'll be is just a very long sentence, 130 words is not uncommon, where you've got just a whole bunch of sentences strung together with conjunctions, basically. I'm not sure, I might perhaps during lunch see if I can dig one out of my system to show you, just to illustrate that in the world, so I'll do that. Ask yourself, what is this sentence actually about? And that might be a strange question, but it really does help to look at it more critically, to understand. And you can make sure that you've got your main keyword at the start that has a close relationship with its verb. Make sure that you've got those relationships well shown within the sentence. And that way, hopefully, you can simplify it so that it's a simple statement of what you're actually trying to say. Check for a finite verb. There are all different kinds of verbs, but the finite verb is the most important, arguably the most important word in the whole sentence. This is the verb that you can inflect or change for past, present, or future. There are other kinds of verbs, such as infinitives. To be, for instance, it's a famous infinitive where you can't inflect it to past, present, or future. It doesn't have that quality about it. The one that you want is harmed, harms, will harm. That's the inflection process. So you'd have to make sure your sentences have got that. And you'll be amazed how often I find sentences that don't have a finite verb. So I get RSI pointing that out to people. Sometimes people will use what is known as a participle, an ing word, instead of a proper finite verb. So they might use the word being, B-E-I-N-G, to operate the sentence, but it's incapable of operating that sentence. So if you've got an ing word, they're perfectly legitimate words. You can use them in different ways. But if you're using it in the place of a finite verb, then it's grammatically incorrect. So watch out for things like that. Once again, I do have some examples of that, which I probably put up during the lunch break. And the prepositional phrases, we had a look at that before. Just watch for that, because that can really make a sentence hard to read. Is the point of the sentence understandable by the target reader on first reading? That's the first read rule that I mentioned. By target reader, it doesn't have to be a lowest common denominator. If you're targeting a highly specialised group through your journal article because it's extremely, you know, targeted on a particular form of science, then you can set it a little bit higher. You know, you can set the technical level and the complexity a little higher. However, a lot of you are going to be publishing in multidisciplinary journals, and that's where you have to just bring it down a few notches in terms of complexity and terminology and things like that, and explain things much more clearly. So we're thinking target reader, and that reader is going to be different for different purposes. So you just have to understand your reader quite well, make sure you're targeting correctly. Avoid common sentence structure pitfalls such as comma splices and lack of parallel structure. I won't go into those for now, but I will send some information about how you can recognise those things. But comma splices are very common where people are not joining the clauses correctly within the sentence. Instead of a conjunction or a semicolon, they're just using a comma. And that will be thrown out by peer reviewers if they have any self-respect. Those peer reviewers are grammar pedants and they like to impose it on other people. So you don't want that. Once again, in a sense, you want the writing to disappear. You don't want them to be seeing the writing because it's so correct that they are not thinking about it. They are just thinking about the ideas. And that's the, you know, that's the nirvana of scientific writing, is being able to achieve that, so that they're not thinking, instead of thinking, that was a brilliant point they've just made about marine hoosers. Instead, they're thinking, that's a comma splice in there. That's terrible writing. Is this person illiterate? So unfortunately, that's how they think. So you've just got to obviate that as much as you can. Okay, is the vocabulary justifiable based on the readership? Technical vocabulary. Now, technical vocabulary to one group of people becomes jargon to another. So you have to be able to be sensitive enough to understand when you're shifting into jargon. And particularly in interdisciplinary journals, what looks perfectly legitimate when you talk to Terry Hughes might not work if you're talking to Helene Marsh, for example. So you have to know that, and you have to be quite flexible in making sure that you are not shifting into jargon. Jargon is a terrible, alienating thing for a reader, so you mustn't use it. And are all the grammatical relationships in the sentence completely clear? So does the subject relate to its verb? Is the direct object working well with both those elements? Are all your clauses working together well? Is everything going together to meaning? and clarity, these things that we're starting to develop as an idea in this class today. Now, I hasten to add that this is not the whole story, and please don't think that I'm obsessed with English, because I'm not. I love it, but I'm not obsessed. I know that there are other factors as well, so I just thought I'd just put this up to so that you understand that I'm not putting English above everything else, because I know there are many other things. And this is actually from a journal editor who says, improving the English will not get a poor piece of research published. It's the research method, rigour, and appropriateness of analysis and findings that are the important things. A paper's structure, the English format and style can always be improved, but little can be done if there is a poor conceptual framework, shallow literature underpinning, inappropriate data collection methods and techniques of analysis, which culminate in superficial conclusions. So it's important that we get some balance into this. But my particular forte is language, so that's what I hope I can help you with. And I would imagine that all of you have got, you know, data collection, analysis, literature, all of those things well and truly under control. So we are just going to tend to focus a bit on the language today. Now, I like to also put up a definition of scientific publication, because we all think we know what it means, but it's sometimes good to be reminded of what scientific publication actually is. And this is the well-accepted definition. It goes right back to 1968, Council of Biology Editors, but it's still used, it still guides a lot of people in understanding scientific publication, so it's worth just having a quick squeeze at it. An acceptable primary scientific publication must be the first disclosure containing sufficient information to enable peers, one, to assess observations, two, to repeat experiments, we'll get to that in a moment, and three, to evaluate intellectual processes. So there is a critical aspect to this where your paper is enabling other people to follow the intellectual process that you've taken. So you lay it out step by step. So that's a very important principle that you need to understand. And in fact, I would suggest, and some of you might disagree, but I would suggest that number three is actually more important than number two. Because in reality, no one replicates other people's experiments. They might do something similar, but they don't follow the exact method. Now, there are some famous exceptions to that. None of you are old enough, God, it depresses me, but none of you are old enough to remember cold fusion in the 1980s. There was a big kerfuffle about the physics of cold fusion, being able to create fusion energy basically for free in a high, you know, reasonably not quite room temperature, but it was called cold, even though it wasn't really cold, but normal fusion takes place at very high temperature. And fabulous paper that came out in America about this, and lots of publicity, you know, people on the news talking about it, and we thought, right, that's it, we've solved all our energy problems, we just get it for nothing now through cold fusion. But then another lab did actually step by step replicate the method, and they found it didn't work. Now, I'm not saying it was fraud, but there was something wrong with how that experiment went together. So that was one case where people did, because there were, you know, very high stakes, of course, in that particular piece of research. But generally, people are not going to go out onto the Great Barrier Reef and try and replicate your methods. But you still have to obviously explain your methods so that people can see how you've achieved what you're setting out to achieve. So that's part of it. But I think the intellectual processes is actually quite a good framework to think about this and how, you know, what you're trying to get into a paper. And, of course, to assess observations. So you're showing your observational data, if that's what you're doing. Not all of you will be quantitative scientists, I suppose. There are some qualitative. Are there qualitative people here? Yes, I'm qualitative. Okay. Most are quantitative. But obviously you're laying that out. You know, you've got tables, you've got graphs, you've got figures of various kinds. So all of that. But I think that final one, intellectual processes, is well worth pondering and thinking about, and thinking about how you can achieve that within the paper that you're writing. Are there any comments at this point? Should we pause just for a moment, maybe just to make a few comments before we go plunging on? Does anyone have a point of view on, those of you who publish in particular, about the idea of revealing the intellectual process? Does anyone sort of experience this in your own publication work? Well, it may be something that you can start to notice now in the work that you're doing. And it certainly helped me to understand the process in my own writing. to think about it in this way, to reveal how I got to the point where I got. Sometimes you, in your own mind, it's all very logical, but when you put it on paper, it looks a bit like leaps of logic sometimes. So you have to be sure that you're showing the step-by-step logic that led you to your conclusions. Okay, so we're going to focus on IMRAD, and all of you know what IMRAD is, presumably, on some level anyway. It's the main way that people write about their research. Introduction, methods, results, and discussion. Now, there are very few journals that actually just have those as headings, of course, and sometimes they don't have it in that order. So I know in chemistry it would be very unusual to have methods second. They would probably have it at the end. But each journal is a little bit different. But each one of these still has to be perfected. So each of the content of the introduction, methods, results, and discussion still have to be perfected, even if they have different titles and they appear in different format, you know, different order in the journal. So we're just going to think about those different things and how they have to contain quite separate kinds of information and are written in different ways, but then they must all come together and cohere as a single document at the end. So the logic of the IMRAD system is very simple. So what question or problem was studied? The answer is in the introduction. How was the problem studied? The answer is in the methods. What were the findings? That's in the results. And what do the findings mean? The most difficult bit, the answer is in the discussion. So it's just a very simple conceptual task then to separate out those bits of information so that they fall into the right place, no matter what your subheadings are. And I've got a Nature article, but things surely changed for him since he published in Nature. There's the lab rat, who's now got a much more like his now. Nature is the one I've chosen, rather than trying to choose a marine science journal, because I'll probably get it wrong, I'll probably choose the wrong one. If you wouldn't mind just taking one and passing on. Okay, so methods, just quickly. This section notionally provides information for another researcher to replicate your work, as we've already discussed. But in reality, it's not really for replication purposes. It's just to show that your work conforms to accepted scientific standards. So that's really all you're doing in this. So it has to be very clear, laid out, sometimes like that journal article, extremely detailed. That is way more detailed than you would normally see, though. So don't feel you have to go into that much detail. And it's always a good idea to consider dividing into relevant subsections, such as site selection, data collection. I have a feeling this guy's got something that looks like that. He's got site-level composition and diversity, human pressure data, modelling, site-level diversity. Those are the sorts of subheadings you can think of. There are a number of others as well. But think about how you're going to divide your methods up so that it's more easy to absorb, because it's not the easiest part of the document to read. So it does help to signpost it a bit more than perhaps you do elsewhere. And you should be linking your methods to your aims as well. So somewhere in your paper, you will show a connection between methods and aims. I mean, that sounds obvious, but sometimes people miss the obvious things. So you should check with target publications to see how they do that very thing. But here's an example, just from the paper that's not related to what you're doing. But we aim to increase our understanding of the success rates in clinical detection of breast cancer using magnetic resonance methods by inspecting the structural features of the cancer's various types. So they're looking to understand success rates, and this is how they're doing it. So a simple statement like that can really clarify, because you're drawing a direct link between your aims and your
methods. This is in your methods, you would have this.
Yes, that's right. Yes.
Okay.
Yes, that's right. Your aims will be in your introduction.
Yeah.
And then you get to this in the method. So this is just making the whole thing coherent, basically, making sure that everything hangs together. I won't get you to do this exercise. You might just like to do it in your own time, to write a statement like that previous one where you're drawing a link between your aims and your methods. And it's something that should appear somewhere. but we'll skip over that because we're fast running out of time. Results. Okay. The research results determine the content and structure of your article. Quite often people write this part first, and then you sort of splay out from there as you go, because the results, that's your raw material, and it's a good starting point, and you've probably got tables or data sets of various kinds, and that's where you're starting from. So there's no really robust formula for how you write a journal article, but it does make sense, particularly at the start, to begin with this. So you must be clear as possible about the story of your results. So what does your research say? That was that exercise earlier. That's going to be a starting point for working on this section. And the take-home messages as well are going to power this. This is going to help you to filter things out, because there's a lot of stuff that during the course of data gathering, a lot of material that you've got, but you have to apply some discernment to what you keep and what you leave out and that kind of thing. So you're using your focus points, those take-home messages and the other stuff that we looked at earlier, what does your results say, what does it mean in context, that sort of stuff is going to help to guide you with this part. We won't do this one either. You might like to do this in your own time, but the first sentence of your results section, making sure that you can instill a take-home message in results. So you want to write it like that, but we'll skip over that for now. Discussion, because the discussion is hard. Yes, Tessa.
Sorry, so sometimes just between those sections, with results and discussion, my supervisor always says to me, lead with your big findings.
Yeah.
So you'll put your big stuff up front, but with a lot of my research, and I assume it's the same for others, it's a sequential thing. So you kind of build the story. So you look at the environment, and then because of that, you can say that, and then you have this big finding, and that's kind of your key. So usually, it's like, in terms of the story, my big findings are at the end of my results, and then in the discussion, you kind of want to structure it the same way and discuss the story.
A narrative.
Whereas, and then they're saying to me, lead with big stuff, but it's kind of go, boom, this is what we found. Oh, and by the way, the environment was like this. It doesn't seem to hold as a story, as a narrative.
I like the narrative idea, and that's probably what I would do. I think your big, finding is what you put into your abstract and potentially into the first part of your introduction. But then you can do the narrative thing in the results, I think. I think that it's fair enough to build up, to get the context just right. It's not like a piece of journalism where you would always start with, your lead at the top and go from there. I think it's okay. You'll look at what your target journal likes people to do as well. But I will put the headline, big finding, massive, amazing new information, just get that out of the way in the abstract. And then people can have that process of discovery of how you got to that point. And that's actually, for someone in the field, that can be quite exciting to see how you actually reach that point. Remembering that we need to outline the intellectual processes. And what you're talking about really is showing the intellectual processes that led to your big finding. So I would actually go with your instinct on that. I think you're right. Yeah. I don't think you have to sort of completely, do the big fireworks and then do the boring stuff later. I think you can build up to the fireworks to a certain extent. Yeah. Okay, so identifying and discussing patterns, and this is, pattern seeking is part of what we're doing, even if you're not consciously aware of it, but you're actually, looking at the fish, out in the field, fabulous data gathering, scuba diving, doing all that. In the end, you're always looking for patterns, and on some level you're sort of forming those patterns even while you're data gathering. You're thinking what these patterns mean, you're looking for contrasts and similarities and anomalies and those kinds of things. There are many ways that you are turning a critical gaze onto the raw data, the sort of flux of data that comes at you. It's in the discussion that you're kind of making those patterns explicit. You're saying what these patterns mean, what this pattern of data leads to, what it might mean in the real world. So the discussion, it's hard to write, but in some ways it's the most important part. It's where you've synthesised this into something that people can use as a new part of knowledge. And you interpret results, of course, but be very careful not to rehash or just repeat things, because that would be jumped on by the peer reviewers and other supervisors and people like that. So it's hard, actually, because you feel like you have to recapitulate certain things. But you've got to find a way to do it in such a way that it looks more like a synthesis rather than a recapitulation. So here we're going from the particular to the general. So we're getting that hourglass thing going. So we've got highly specific information through, you know, throughout the middle of the paper. And then you're starting to step it out again. So you're looking, you're talking much more in terms of patterns now, of broader statements you can make about what this means. You know, perhaps extrapolating, you know, various kinds of reasoning, inductive and deductive reasoning may come into this as well if you want to get a bit philosophical. But you're, that's all that does is just sort of broaden it out to have more universal applicability, and that's what you're trying to do at this point, to make it as broad as possible. So the opposite to the introduction. And you're showing clearly how this research can be used or even potentially not used if that's relevant to what you've got. And you don't introduce new data, of course. I think you already know that instinctively, but that's always a bad look. And while you must deal with limitations, certainly, in your paper somewhere, try to do that within the methods rather than overemphasising at the end. I always like people to end on a positive note, you know, what you have found, not what you weren't able to do or beyond the scope of the study or we didn't get what we thought we were going to get. You know, that stuff, yes, you can deal with that elsewhere, but keep the discussion for the positive contribution that you're making if you possibly can. So I'll get you to do this exercise very quickly to write the final sentence of your paper. Mindful of the need at this point to synthesise. Now, this is bloody difficult and it's not fair for me to do this to you on a Friday afternoon. But just think back to the final sentence of the conclusion in the paper we looked at earlier. It was very brief. It was, you know, ending on a high note with concerted action and the right societal choices, global sustainability of local biodiversity may be an achievable goal. So that's how these people, this cast of thousands, how they ended their paper. I haven't counted the number of words. It looks to be about 17, something like that. Keep yours to under 25, but write the final sentence of the discussion of your paper and see how you go. I know it's late in the day, see how you go. We just take 5 minutes to do it, just short and sharp. Okay, I want to hear your final sentences of your journalizables. So who'd like to volunteer?
So my final sentence is exhibiting both type 2 and type 3 functional responses, large populations and a diverse community of active response central fishers should be considered to provide resilience for coral reefs against devastating collapses caused by a cluster.
Okay, thank you for that. What do we think? It's a little long.
Yeah.
And it's what you were saying before, I think, when you read it out, it's you get a different impression of it than when you just see it on the page. And that might be the case for you. As you're reading it out, you're perhaps feeling that it was a little too long. Did you feel that as you were going through?
Yeah,
it's
written down, it actually wasn't that long. It's only 2 lines. But, yeah, reading it out.
Yeah. I think it's got a lot of parts to it. I don't know how many words it is. I couldn't judge, but it would be well over 20. Right, just do a count to see, because I'm curious. Okay, 35. What I didn't say before is that the final sentence should be similar in length to the opening sentence. So 25 or less is a good idea. So you could lose 10 words. It might mean splitting it into two, and that's fine. Or it might just mean refining what you're trying to say and saying fewer words. There was quite a bit going on in that sentence. I think it could well be worth splitting it into two. Is there an obvious place you think it could be split?
I could just start it at large populations instead of having a bit about the type 2 and type 3 functional responses.
Because grammatically, the way you set that up, you had an adjunct phrase at the start before getting to subject, verb, object. There's a lot to be said, particularly for these very important sentences, the first and the last sentences, to keep it simple. So just start with the subject, verb, object stuff and just actually read that out now without that adjunct information. Just reading out the subject from object part. Let's see what we think now.
Large populations and diverse community of plankton-response-centric fishes should be considered to provide resilience for coral reefs against devastating collapses caused by ecosystem.
I'm more comfortable with that now, actually. Now that it's just a more, it's simpler grammar, it's a lot shorter, and it starts out stronger, I think. You always run the risk, when you have an adjunct phrase at the start of a sentence, you run the risk of diluting the power of that sentence. And I think in that case it did dilute it a bit, whereas now it's much more direct, stronger, and you know, just a very good statement now. So I think that was simply an easy fix. If you need that other information, you can deploy it in other ways. You can perhaps have it in, you know, in part of the sentence before that, or you could add a phrase in perhaps to the final sentence. There's always a way, that's the thing about language. You can always find a different way of doing it. But I'm happy with that now. I think that's really good. Thank you. Anyone else with a final sentence? Go on, okay. You know you want to.
Marine reserves remain a powerful tool in conserving biodiversity and sustaining fisheries, but integrated land management practices prove essential in maintaining reserve performance.
Okay, what do we reckon? That's what is known as a compound sentence. It's joined by conjunction but.
Yeah, yeah,
that's right, which is a coordinating conjunction.
And
you know
was,
all this stuff, obviously.
It was long, but it was fine. I was able to understand it, maybe because of that. Yeah, because it was like kind of like, yeah, so I didn't mind.
I think so. Compound sentences, particularly when you limit it to just those two main clauses which you've got, which you've joined with a single conjunction, so we're not going over all the conjunctions or other things, it's establishing a relationship between two entities within a sentence, and I think you've done that quite effectively. It was a bit long, and there might be a case for removing the odd word here.
Yeah.
Did your word count?
I think it's 21.
Oh, that's okay. 21's fine. Yeah, I've got no problem with 21. And the structure is... while it's got more complexity than a single clause sentence, it's we're not feeling overloaded by the complexity. We can handle it. And you've made a very solid, strong point at the end. So, I think just have a look at some of the function words, you know, the non-keywords, just to see if you can draw them in a bit. But overall, I think that was fine. It was good. Anyone else? No? Okay. I won't push you too hard. Just in the remaining few minutes, we're just going to try something a little different now, because I want to talk titles of journal articles. Very neglected. Sometimes people don't put a lot of effort into these, and that's why they end up with great long things. So I just want you to think about your titles a little differently. The abstract of the abstract. Now, I know some of the God supervisors like to be funny with their titles. They like to have puns and do funny things. But I'm not going to suggest that you do that. I think you should see the title as very informative. So abstract of the abstract. When you get to a certain point where you're an emeritus professor or a distinguished professor, you can do whatever you damn well want. But when you're first starting out, you probably keep it fairly straight down the line. So abstract of the abstract. Attracting attention to the ideas in your paper, and obviously that's a very good thing. You want to change the world, of course, so you can't do that unless people notice you. So the more revealing your title is, the more easily they're going to judge its relevance and importance. So it's pretty important. But also, it's very important that you match your title to the exact claims you're making in your paper, just like a newspaper headline. It mustn't distort the message. And you mustn't raise expectations that you cannot deliver. And unfortunately, some journal article titles do raise expectations, and when you start reading through, you find it's also qualified and so diluted that whatever was said in the title was actually a little bit of clickbait. You know? So that's unfortunate. So you have to be very careful. So once again, I come back to the idea of keywords. These are the words that you deploy very carefully, just as this guy did, these past thousands did in this paper, where they had 9 words, but it was, you know, it was a noun phrase, so there wasn't a lot going on, it was just descriptive, but it actually got people in the right area straight away. So that's what you need to do. And of course, they're picked up by the search engines, you know, scholarly scanning software and that kind of thing. And also just the fact that in English, you know, other languages are different, but in English, it does tend to favour placing the most important words first. So you might as well use that, because that can really help you. For example, this one is not so good at the top, effects of added calcium on salinity tolerance of tomato plants. Actually, what we're talking about is calcium, so get that to the start. Calcium addition improves salinity tolerance of tomato plants. Now, can you notice the difference in grammar as well? Can anyone say what that difference is? It's not just the placement of keywords.
The first one doesn't have a finite verb.
Exactly, yeah, that's right. This is therefore a noun phrase, which is just descriptive. This one's got a finite verb, improves. That is a much stronger statement. As soon as you stick a verb in, then you're really saying what happened. Now, you might not want to say what happened. These people used a noun phrase. That's fine if you just want to be descriptive. But a more striking title is one like the second one, which makes a statement. It makes an assertion. So you can do it like that if you feel able to. Once again, it comes down to what you feel you can say. You know, how strong your evidence is, how strong your conclusions are. But if you've got pretty strong conclusions, then consider using a sentence instead of a phrase. And that is going to get more attention. You've got to keep it succinct. Fewest words to describe the contents. Unfortunately, too many journal paper titles are long, convoluted, and opaque. Horrible, horrible, horrible. What I want yours to be is short, direct, and transparent. So those words need to inform how you write your titles. But not too short and uninformative. So, Action of Antibiotic on Bacteria is a terrible title in 2016. It might have been a brilliant title in 1934 when it was still a new field. But now, so much is known that no one would really think that that was going to be cutting edge when it's so broad like that. So, you have to make sure you're getting it just in the right spot. And the grammar is important. That's another noun phrase example. Systems of weed control and peanuts is just a descriptive noun phrase title. But the sentence, like this one, protonaceous metabolites from pyrophoria teres contribute to symptom development of barley net blotch. What's the finite verb there?
Contribute.
That can be inflected for past, present, and future, so that's the technical way you work it out. And it's not a particularly strong assertion, but it's still an assertion. Much more than just the noun phrase. Then there's the old-fashioned binomial title, and there are different ways of doing this, but here's one from a journal article that I use sometimes to show students. Paroxetine in the treatment of severe non-dermatological pruritus, colon, a randomised controlled trial in which the methodology is stated in the second part of the binomial. So that's also quite a useful thing if you're particularly in the medical science, not so much in what you're doing, randomised controlled trials being the gold standard, it's a good idea to get that into your title. So that's why they did that, I think. But quite often in older literature, if you look at journal articles going back 30 years or more, you'll see that form of title, the binomial title. Yes?
I have to say, I don't know why, favourite titles like this. And I quite like to have like a catchy little thing, and then I have a more serious description. Is that all right, or is it at our level? Like you're saying, that maybe I should be careful with.
You should certainly be careful and not try to be too clever. But I don't have a problem. My own thesis.
So like a serious, and then it's all like a general, like a something that's I don't know.
There was one from this very centre recently. It was a PhD student who did something like that. It was something to do with. It had a double entendre, excuse my French, but where it was something like, what was it?
My girlfriend did Good in the Sack.
That's it, that's the one. Thank you. Good in the Sack. That was the one.
Talking about embryo development and.
That was the one.
Yes, yeah, so you had like a little short, sweet thing, and then you go to the more serious.
Then you put the more descriptive.
So this is acceptable for our level?
Well, was that Jen Atherton?
Yeah,
it was Jen. Okay, so she was, I think she's finished now, but at that time she was a PhD student, and that was, you know, a bit daring for her to do that. But I think it worked for her.
Jen.
And then there was Erica Woolsey from here. I think she had one that said hard coral porn, I think that was part of her.
Was that? She had a t-shirt that said that.
She certainly had a t-shirt.
That was, yeah,
right. I may be wrong about it being in a journal,
yeah,
but for some reason,
she, yeah, she
it was lodged in my head that it was in a journal full time as well. I don't know. Look, it's okay, so long as you're not going too far overboard and you've got that serious bit as well. I think the serious bit is pretty important.
Yeah, I haven't, like, with my title, I read the one I submitted, I wasn't that, like, yeah, full on. But still, it was a bit like I wanted to try and catch people.
Yeah.
But I don't know.
Some people used jokes and puns and also, well, the ones we mentioned are puns. So if you're very sure of yourself and you think you can get away with it, then you should do it, because it can attract attention. Sometimes it can attract wrong attention, but it's, you know, it's something you could pick up and run it past you in time. And yeah, I just think you do have to be a little careful, because you don't want to get the wrong kind of attention. Anyway, but yeah, I mean, in my case, my thesis, mine wasn't a pun. It was actually, I took a quote from an ancient Greek philosopher, just a couple of words, and so that was almost literary, I suppose, and then I had a colon, and then I had more serious stuff after that, and that was, you know, it seemed to work for what I was doing. So there's, you know, you're not completely restricted, but you just sort of build up to the more witty stuff later when you are a professor. Question titles, these are popping up more and more now. These are, I think they're a little risky. I don't know what you think, because they're kind of, you know, rhetorical questions, I suppose, or they might raise a fairly negative answer coming back at you. I don't know. But here's a real one from a real journal article. Which insect introductions succeed and which fail? So I don't know whether that works as a title.
It's pretty good because it's attention grabbing. It's in plain English, so
yeah,
any person who sort of, maybe it's not their particular field.
Don't ask me a question. I'm asking the question. You tell me the answer. That's why I'm reading this paper. Tell me the answer.
You have to, like, go searching for, like, oh, I wonder what their aims were.
I guess what it's saying is, this is the question that you should be interested in. Now I'm going to tell you the answer.
Yeah, but tell me that in the title. Because
yeah,
now I'm going to have to think about it, and I'm going to have to read the abstract. If the title doesn't catch me right away, then I'm... So, and then if the abstract doesn't get me, then I'm
yes,
like...
Yes.
Please, no.
No questions, how does everyone else go, anyway,
yeah. I'm going to see question title. It's just an interesting phenomenon, though, because I don't remember seeing them, you know, a while back, but now they do seem to be popping up quite a bit. And they can be provocative. So maybe that is the right choice for you. It's just worthwhile thinking about it anyway, is a possibility, but they do potentially cause problems as well along the lines of we've just been hearing. You also have to be very careful to avoid ambiguity. If you're choosing a verbless noun statement, so, you know, a noun phrase, which generally means use of adjectives, just be careful, because if you load up your adjectives, you could run into some problems. Soybean seedling growth suppression. Does this mean suppression of soybean seedlings or by soybean seedlings? When you start stringing adjectives together, you run the risk of losing track of what those adjectives are modifying. So it's better to say suppression of soybean seedling growth, to be absolutely clear. So just if this is just a simple check, if you've got a title that has more than two adjectives before a single noun, just then, how can I turn that around so I have something that's a bit more acceptable? Then you'll get rid of the ambiguity. So just be careful of that. Now, we're not going to have time to do this exercise, but I'm just going to run you through what's involved, and you might like to do it in your own time. Because it's actually, I think, a really useful exercise. It's in considering the implications of your title. Once again, not raising expectations that you can't fulfil. So this is a really good exercise. Now, this is a real journal article, Bird Use of Rice Field Strips of Varying Widths in the Kanto Plain of Central Japan. That was, you know, that's a noun phrase, title, descriptive. You can see straight away what it's about. Okay, so having read that, the reader is going to have some expectations. So what will the reader expect to read about in an article with this title? And just there's a reminder of what the title is. So they're going to read about the relationship of birds to rice fields, the significance of the width of rice field strips, correlation between the width of strips and the number and species of the birds using them, and the reason the research was in central Japan. It's usually something you can say about the geographic location. Okay, so instantly, on some level, the reader is going to expect those things. So you have to make sure you deliver. So, arising from that, these are the questions that must be answered so that you can be sure that you are fulfilling the expectations that the reader has instantly when they read that title. So why was the width of strips an important variable? Did the width of the rice field affect which birds used it? If so, which field strip width was used most by which birds? How did the researchers measure bird use? Would the experiment be worth repeating for rice field strips in other places? And so on. That's just a few. But there are instant expectations. And you then have to make sure, as you are preparing your journal article, that every one of those things is answered. So what I want you to do in your own time, because we've run out of time now, is to either write or revisit. So you could write a fresh title or just go back to one that you've already written. And then come up with a set of expectations that your readers may have as a result of that title. And so just come up with those questions. And then when you are doing your journal article, make sure that you have answered those questions within the journal article and quite often within the introduction. So I find that quite useful besides for people to do. So that's really it for now. The final word is, this is very true, the desire to write grows with writing, said Erasmus. And the more you do it, including right from the very start, and some of you are right at the start now, the more you do it, the more you'll feel like you're able to do it, the more you'll want to do it, the more benefit you get from writing, the more reward you get, the better feedback you get from your supervisors, that's always a good incentive. So you just need to keep doing it. And even if what you write now does not appear in that form in a journal article or in your thesis, it's not wasted because it's all part of the process of practicing.